everyone, and welcome to the second episode of Season 2 of Throw Like a Girl Radio. Today is Wednesday, September 9th. I'm Alyssa Paolicelli.
And I'm KaraAnne Galante.
We are here with you for the next hour on 12:12 p.m. right before your lunch break. As always, thank you for tuning in to Throw Like a Girl Radio today. If you can listen to us in a number of different ways, first by streaming off of mywbcr.com or downloading the TuneIn Radio app and searching Brooklyn College Radio. Make sure you're following us on all of our social media accounts, facebook.com/throwlikeagirlradio, Twitter @throwlikea_girl, and Instagram @throwlikeagirlradio. Plus, subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can listen to our episodes as many times as you want for as long as you want by searching Throw Like a Girl Radio on YouTube. Did you get us on iTunes yet?
Not yet, but
we're working on that.
We're getting there slowly. So, guys, fall is fastly approaching. Woohoo! So what does that mean? Football preseason is underway, baseball is heating up, and hockey season can come soon enough. If you guys would like to join in on our conversation, the number to call is 718-951-4444. Don't forget, that is a number you can always call in and join our conversation at any point during the hour. 718-951-4444. We are going to change it up a bit this week and start it off with
the
confessions of a female sports fan as our first segment of the day.
We have lots of Mets and Rangers stuff to talk about. It's our favorite, so we're going to start off with this.
Yes.
So the other day, Kara and I were talking with one of our friends who's also a female who's interested in getting to the sports world, and we're talking about, because we're seniors, so applying to jobs is really scary. So we're talking about it, and as we're looking at what the networks are asking for as part of your portfolio to apply, you basically need a modeling portfolio as a woman, and guys don't. You need just a headshot.
Yeah.
Which is absurd. But honestly, if you think about it, even if you go on like Craigslist and I was looking for a job like waitressing and all those things, you still do need a headshot. But the fact that you need an entire portfolio, basically an amateur modeling portfolio, is insane. And it really just, it stinks. Because like, I'm not a model. Like, I'm 5'2". Like, there's no way I'm ever going to be a model. Like,
I know, I'm not that skinny.
Not even that. Just like, know, no one's going to sign, like, it's kind of discouraging because, like, obviously that is weighed in tremendously into the decision for getting a job.
Yeah, I don't even know where to start. Even getting headshots to begin with, I don't know how to do it, where to start. There's, like, no class or to teach you, you know, how to get into the sports industry and be a broadcaster. Like, who do you turn to? Because professors, they can only teach you so much, but knowing more like in depth about the industry, and it just sucks like being a girl and having to have that modeling portfolio even though I've never modeled a day in my life.
Exactly. And nor should I, because I'm just, that's not my calling in life. So
I know. It's really not. I don't know how to model what you have to go
and headshots school. And like modeling portfolios, I'm assuming, is a very big expense for someone who's coming out of college.
Yeah.
Like, I know that headshots go for like a cheap headshot,
yeah,
like $200 for like a few pictures, which is nothing, and eventually you have to replace those every so often because, like, you obviously get older and your looks change.
And plus, we have to find an agent too now.
Yeah,
I'm hearing
agents, all this agent stuff. I mean, that's for both sides of the idea.
Yeah.
It's just really unfair that the photo portfolio for a female applicant is so much larger than it is for a male.
No, it is. It's definitely unfair. I don't even know. I thought that was absurd. And
it's really
scary.
Discouraging too, because it's like, I should be based on my talent alone.
I know,
not anything else.
Yeah.
So, like, I mean, I think about that for most jobs and most things in life, but when the aspect, and like obviously looks do go take a big part because ratings and all the other,
yeah, people want to watch a pretty face on the screen.
Exactly, because it brings, you know, if someone thinks that you're pretty, they're going to be tuned into that station over somebody else, which is what the network wants.
But with guys, you see male broadcasters, and I don't see, like,
I know, and they're all, like, old white
David
guys.
David Beckham on the screen, like, looking man, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's so true. That's true, too, because, like, I mean, I guess the clientele is still majority male, so, you know.
Yeah, but I have the credibility. If I have the credibility and the knowledge, I think that should, you know, go over my looks and the
I agree 100%.
You know,
100%.
But that's our little rant
for the day. That's this week's problem with the sports world.
Yes, it is. Well, we're going to head into break right now. When we come back, we're going to talk about the innings controversy surrounding Mr. Matt Harvey. And here is a little
audio from
Kevin Burke. I know he's on Fox Sports 1 now.
Throwing it back to his Mets days.
Yes. And here's some audio. Enjoy.
Yesterday was about the Mets and Matt Harvey, his agent Scott Boras basically putting it out there. Hey, 180, that's the inning limit on Matt Harvey. He's already pitched 166 plus. So that's what we heard last night. It was kind of a shocker because this was news apparently to the Mets. And so Harvey today talked about this, addressing the media, and asked, whose decision is this?
I'm going to always play, but, you know, I hired Dr. Andrews to do my surgery, and I hired Scott for a reason, and that's to prolong my career and, you know, put me in the best possible position. And moving forward with that, I have one start in mind, and that's Tuesday. Yeah. For me, the biggest thing is if I let any of the outside distractions get in the way, then, you know, I'm not doing my job to get us to October anyway. So for me, it's keeping my head down and focusing on Tuesday.
Well, you just created the outside distraction, Matt. That's the problem with this. And yes. This is a nightmare for the Mets. Make no mistake about it. I mean, they were on a decision to, you know, since the All-Star break, since they realized they were in this playoff chase, they started to go to a six-man rotation. They started to do things to plan for this. And he balked at that at the time. So this is interesting. Our Ken Rosenthal, our other insider here with JP, did talk to Scott Boras a little while ago. And Boras said this to Ken, quote, "Matt Harvey wants to pitch. We're trying to work out a plan that the doctor approves of."
Okay, well, that was...
those are those comments from Matt Harvey.
I couldn't agree with Kevin Burkhart more that Matt Harvey started this whole controversy.
I hate when situations have it like this, because this is the time when you realize that sports is not this extraterrestrial force or this, you know, thing that unites people. It's purely a for-profit business. And that's when I hate when that happens, when it shows in the game, because you love it for that, because it doesn't seem like that on the field. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And like, it doesn't seem like that on the ice. It doesn't seem like that on the court. But at the end of the day, that's
all
what it is.
It comes down to money.
As a fan, it stinks, because you're like, well, this guy is, he's our saving grace, Matt Harvey. Like,
people, he's a dark knight.
Like, live and die for his starts.
Are you kidding me?
They do. And now he's saying all of a sudden, like, this is the first time in so long the Mets fans are so excited that we're going to probably be playing in late October.
For the first time in almost 10 years.
And now you're like, wait, but my arm. Like, are you kidding me?
Yeah, like, the big thing is now they're talking about it. You know what I mean? Like, it's like perfect timing.
Like, okay, you should have talked about it 3 weeks ago. When, you know, I mean, he's at 171 and 0.1 innings after last night's start.
Yes. So he has one more start left, apparently.
Right, but I think he's going to make his next start, and they said they would possibly start him again if they needed to in the National Series.
Yes.
Which, and everyone's freaking out because, like, they think that we need Matt Harvey to get to, you know, to beat the Nationals, which, like, okay, last night we didn't. And, like,
Matt Harvey was the one who gave up, you know, 7 runs. And that was, like, the last time this was the second time in his career that he's done that.
Yeah, I think it was eight singles he gave up.
Yeah, but, you know, we got to give him a little break, because that was a bad hop on that single in
like,
center field with Cespedes.
About that.
You can't do anything about that, but...
But, like, he should have...
He was a little shaky.
Obviously the outside distractions, like, shouldn't. Yeah. But I don't know. He's the biggest competitor on the team. I'm putting quotes in the air for anyone who's listening.
Yeah.
Being sarcastic here, but like, I don't know. I expected him to come out much bigger and with much more fire than he did last night.
I think Terry Collins was saying he was overthrowing the ball because he wanted to prove himself. So he was like pushing it a little bit too much with his pitches.
Right.
And he was putting too much of that oomph into those pitchers, and maybe that's why he wasn't playing as on point as he usually does.
Right.
And the big thing about this is how Boras and Alderson, how they interpreted Dr. Andrews's.
I don't understand why this obviously was talked about before.
Like, no, it was definitely spoken about.
Like, obviously in preseason, when you say, okay, this is the plan for the season, you want to be optimistic and say, well, what happens in the playoffs, but you don't want to say that and like limit his starts from then. You know what I'm saying? Like,
there was
no telling that the Mets, everyone was excited and had the hype, but there was no telling. Like, did you really honestly think that you would be playing like they would come back from 7-1 last night? No. I mean, I didn't. I didn't watch last night because I didn't think they were going to.
With the way this team was going, I just wanted to keep watching, because I feel like they keep coming back and just fighting for more. Like, Cespedes has been on fire.
Oh, Cespedes is, like, not even human.
Kirk Newenheim.
He's the Henrik Lundqvist on the
I don't even know what's going on, but with this inning controversy, which is so up in the air, what I read I think it was this like a New York Post article that Pedro Martinez, who, you know, he played for the Mets in 2005, 2008, he was injured most of his time. He's saying that you can't trust the Mets when it comes to injuries. You can't trust them, can't trust what they say and things like that. He like made a whole tweet about the Mets and how you shouldn't trust what they say. And I kind of agree with him.
I don't know, because but think about it, this year they've skipped his starts. They've skipped Syndergaard's starts. They've gone to the six-man rotation to prevent the overuse of pitching arms. They had a plan in place for the health of the pitchers. They know that the Mets organization knows that this is the pitching is what they have. That is
that's
what
they
built for so long, now they have it.
But
and
you don't
want to
ruin
it.
You don't want to ruin it. Yeah,
and I think they've gone out of their way to take steps to preserve it.
Yeah, but okay. Scott Boras said some things that
we just talk about how much I hate Scott Boras.
I know I hate Scott Boras too.
He has a great eye for talent, but like. He also represents
He sees dollar signs when he signs a player.
Well,
it's so obvious. But what Boras was worried about, and this is him, what he said was, if you exceed your career high innings total and you do it in your second season after Tommy John surgery, so he's about to exceed his career high innings pitched this season, and he's doing it right after Tommy John surgery. All those guys had complications, and all those guys had problems after exceeding your inning limit.
I actually read, I think, a similar article by our girl Katie Strang.
Yes,
she's now covering baseball instead of hockey. But she published an article saying that Boras did bring up four pitchers.
Yeah, he did.
Who pitched over who never pitched 200 innings in their career prior to Tommy John surgery, and that meant that only one of them didn't need a second surgery. So, like, obviously the risk is pretty big.
It is pretty big.
I don't even know if that made sense, what I just said.
It did. It's like, for example, if you pitched 177 innings last season, you go for Tommy John surgery and you're pitching now 180 innings.
Right.
And that's exceeding that original inning limit that you had last season. And plus you had surgery on top of that. That's risking a pitcher's arm.
Yeah. So Sean Markham was the only one who did not require a second Tommy John surgery out of the four others who had never pitched 200 innings but approached that in their second season back from the surgery.
Yeah.
And he said, personally, he would sacrifice the long term to try to win the World Series. I've been to the postseason once in 2011 with the Brewers, and ever since I've been trying to get back. Matt Harvey knows what an opportunity he has here. As everyone says, like, this is the Mets are, like, on the incline. Like, this is only the beginning. Like, maybe it is, but it's a lot. Baseball, like, look at the Nats. The Nats were favored to win.
Yes.
And now, look at that. Like, anything can happen. Any moves can be made in the offseason.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
The idea that he's going to, I get, you know, Matt Harvey's arm is his lifeline.
That's his career.
Exactly.
That's what makes him.
So, like, you're a competitor, right? So don't you want to play at the highest level as soon as you can?
Yeah, no. Like, I feel like, you see, all the Mets fans got really annoyed at with Matt Harvey is that he's like, I don't want to pitch in the postseason, it seemed like. But then he goes to the Players Tribune, which is run by Derek Jeter, and he writes,
because he's going to be a Yankee one day.
Yeah, and
he loves
because he was scared that he was being depicted as a selfish player now, since he's like cares about his arm. Because before he's like, oh, I'm definitely pitching in the playoffs, I'm going for it, all that stuff. And now he writes in the Players Tribune that. I was reading, he wrote, like, he's definitely going to pitch in the playoffs.
Together,
he's guaranteeing it. He's going through the...
We are coming up with a plan to reach an innings limit during the season. It will be a compromise between the doctors, the Mets organization, to get me and the team to where we need to be for our postseason run. I understand the risk. I'm also fully aware of the opportunity the Mets have this postseason. Winning the division and getting to the playoffs is our goal. Once we are there, I will be there.
You see, I'm so confused.
It's...
Because now I'm hearing two different sides, and Sandy Alderson's very, like, tiptoey around the situation because he's not guaranteed.
Scott Boras isn't talking back.
I know.
And
I'm
not
so
reaching out to him. Well, from what's been reported,
like, Sandy Alderson was saying that if it came down to, like, the last series, which is against the Nationals of the
MLB,
of the season,
did a great job scheduling the Mets this year.
I know. If,
like,
it came
hats
down
off to whoever did that.
If it came down to a do or die series, Matt Harvey would be pitching, and it would seem like a playoff situation. He would be pitching. But other than that, it's just up in the air after that. So, I don't know. Now Matt Harvey's saying he wants to pitch in the playoffs, but...
According to a report from USA Today, close to the Mets that remained anonymous because of the sensitivity of the topic.
Okay.
If Harvey pitches Tuesday, he will be skipped in his next scheduled start. start one more time and wouldn't make another regular season start unless they needed on the final week of the season against the Nationals.
Yes.
So, and if the Mets do make the playoffs, he won't start more than once during the potential playoff series and perhaps could be limited to no more than 60 pitches in a start, which is scary as a Mets fan, like I said before.
Yeah, 60 pitches,
you...
That's three innings, isn't it?
Yeah.
About three innings, so...
Actually took a picture of one of the stats from last night. Like, he obviously didn't have the best outing, but
no, it was he. It wasn't.
There was
he wasn't as sharp as
used. Five and one third innings pitched, eight hits, seven earned runs, which is the highest ever.
Yes, for him.
Two walks and six strikeouts. He had 74 pitches, 53 of which were strikes. That's not bad.
No, like, that's not bad. It's just it was that it wasn't an error. It was just that awkward bounce, and also he gave up two runs in the first inning too.
Yeah. Our pitchers tend to start off a little shaky.
Yeah.
Like especially Syndergaard.
Yeah, Cologne. But you can't do that if we go into the playoffs. You can't do that, guys.
Yeah. Well,
we can't. We got to be more solid.
But this also had happened to the Nationals with Strasburg in 2013, I believe it was.
Yeah, when he went
and
for
they
Tommy
shut
Joe.
Him down. They,
yeah,
they
yeah,
were
they
like,
did.
No, like,
Boris
we're not
wants to treat
him.
It like Strasburg. He's like, I thought we were doing
didn't,
this.
I think Boris was Strasburg's client at the time. I don't quote me on that. I'm going to look that up now.
No,
but
look
I'm
it
pretty
up.
Sure
go for
he
it.
Was.
He probably was, honestly. Boris represents probably
so,
everybody in Major
Leagues.
I was looking
up about him last night, and he is the number one sports agent in the world, which is crazy thinking. Yeah. That I don't think he represents any of any soccer stars. He just purely does
baseball.
American sports. But he had, like, Conforto. He has Conforto, and I'm
obsessed.
So,
dude, that's
I am
scary.
Obsessed
that
with Conforto.
Is so, I'm obsessed, and I'm scared. Don't like. But this Matt Harvey situation has given everyone headaches. And Alderson was a little bit aggravated because he was, quote, in saying, for a guy to say to us on the 29th of August, 180 innings, and then you're going to shut him down. Don't call me 7 months later and tell me you're pulling the rug out from under me, not after all we've done to protect the player. So Alderson's a little frustrated with Scott Boras's comments about this whole situation, and it's just insane, and we'll see what happens.
I think it'll be interesting to – I mean, I just don't think that there was – everyone's blaming the Mets. I blame Harvey because
Harvey put himself in this situation.
Then you should have
with the comments.
You should have said, "Don't start me until May," or "Don't start me until April," so that you had the extra starts. I mean, it's just a hard situation because you can't predict the postseason. You really can't. You can't predict where you're going to be in September. You can't predict that you're going to be playing these meaningful games in October. Like, you just can't do that. Honestly, there was no telling that he was going to come back and be the ace that he is right now.
Yeah, there was. We don't know. Tommy John surgery is always up in the
air.
Exactly.
So I think
what happens after.
I think that it was a publicity move on Boris's part in order to make Matt Harvey seem like the victim in the situation.
Yeah, but Matt Harvey seems like the villain now.
Poor timing. Are you kidding me? You're going into the most important series of the season of the last decade.
You know what I've noticed? That always usually like it usually happens with the Mets. Like something always pops up at the critical points in the season. Every time the Mets are up, I know, I'm getting, sorry, like, no, it's frustrating, like, something always comes up with the Mets, we can never have, like, a smooth ride or anything like that, there's always something coming up, and I know Terry Collins, I was watching a video, and he was, like, saying that he feels bad for Harvey, that the player should have never been involved in the situation to begin with.
Yeah, I mean,
like, he knows
Wright
he wants to pitch.
Yeah, for four innings on the bench the other day, because they thought that it might affect the locker room, which... If I'm on in that locker room, if I'm Lucas Duda and I'm coming off the DL, I'm like, hey, like, I'm not in the best like, think about it. No one really is 100% when they go into the playoffs in any sport.
No, yeah, and plus you're playing it's not over 100 games now we've been playing, so the body's a little bit under fatigue.
Yeah,
you
like,
know.
I don't know, I'd be upset. Like, this guy doesn't even want to pitch in the playoffs. Like, we're all so pumped to be here right now at this point.
Yeah.
And this guy is not, he's just not having it. Like,
yeah, no, that and after you're promising even preseason, promising the Mets fans all this stuff, and then this drama comes up, it's just, it's something that hurts just a little bit. But you found out that agent Scott Boras...
He was Strasburg's agent at the time of the shutdown. So this is not untreaded waters for Boras. So.
I know. I think just Boras likes to stir up controversy all the time.
Probably.
He likes that. Maybe he was just bored. He has nothing else to do.
I don't know if he was bored. I think he's just looking out for his dollar signs. Which
I know.
Understandably so. But like I said, this is just these situations I can't stand because it reminds me that this isn't just because people love the game. It's at the end of the day, it's for profit business, and that's how it's treated, and that's how That's how it's always going to be.
That's how you...
No matter what way you code it, that's how it is.
So get ready, Mets fans, because there's probably going to be more controversy coming up with Matt Harvey, but we'll see. Let's hope it is squashed before next week. Let's hope. But, well, we're going to go into another break, guys, and now you guys are going to be hearing highlights from that incredible win yesterday. We're going to hear Harry Roses, who's the voice of the New York Mets radio.
Yeah, Howie Rose also has a great... The last call is my favorite, so make sure you're listening.
Yes, make sure to like listen to this. And here it is.
To left field, down the line, gone if it's fair. It is a home run! A home run for David Wright. He turns a fastball around. It hits it deep into the lower left field stands, just to the right of the foul pole. And so the Washington lead is cut to 2-1.
3-2 pitch, swing and a... Base hit into center field as it rolls towards Taylor. One run scores. It'll be runners at the corners now, and the Mets are back to within 7-2. 3-1 to Granderson. Here's Rivero's pitch, taken, and it's outside, ball four at 7-3. Cespedes will bat as the tying man. Here's a 1-0 pitch. Swing and a shot down the left field line, fair ball. One run in, two runs in. Granderson steamrolls around. He's coming home. It's a bases-clearing double. Yoenis Cespedes has made it 7-6. And the Met fans are being heard from now. One more hit in the inning. The Mets will tie it. If they hit it out, they go ahead. They answer. The Nationals had four in the bottom of inning six. The Mets have five with the meter still running in the top of the seventh. Three balls, no strikes to Duda, who's got a huge strike zone. Here's the pitch. He takes it inside. This game's tied. Drew Storen walks another one. Cespedes trots home, touches home plate. It's 7-up.
The 1-0 pitch. Into the air to deep right center. This baby's going. It is going. It is gone. Holy smokes. Kirk Nieuwenhuis has given the Mets the lead with a pinch hit home run. Into the seats in right center field, beyond the 16-foot out-of-town scoreboard. This place is in shock.
So Throw Like a Girl Radio with Alyssa Paolicelli and KaraAnne Galante is back. We're with you until 12 p.m. Mets fans, if you want to join our conversation, the number to call is 718-951-4444. You just heard Howie Rose and Lewin's call from last night's game. I love the home run call.
That was amazing.
Love it. So let's talk about last night. This should be fun.
Yeah, I know. Well, I was watching that amazing game, that amazing comeback.
I had a ton of homework. And now I'm like a little superstitious. Should I watch tonight? Should I not? I also have a lot of homework tonight, so I probably won't.
I think
won't.
You should do what you keep. But like, I'm going to like sit in the same spot in my living room and watch the game, have my computer on my lap, and do homework. That's what I did last night. So let's hope that the streak keeps going. But, okay, so we were talking about Matt Harvey, shaky start in the beginning, gave up two runs in the beginning. David Wright comes up in the bottom of the first, hits
David,
a home run.
Before we even move on, let's just stop and talk about David Wright for a little bit.
All right, let's talk about
it. And on Monday's game, when he scored that run and did that whole,
celebration. Oh, yes, I wanted to bring that up.
You don't even know. I was, like, freaking out. Like, that was just gave me such chills. Like, this guy is pumped. I'm so happy he's back.
He's ready, baby.
Like, he's ready. He's done. Oh, Mike, it just, like, warmed my heart. Like, I was like, yes. Like, this guy finally is just, you know, everyone's like, he's so clutch. Like, okay, this is the biggest hit he's had in 7 years. Like,
I know. He's not.
But he's back.
No, and, he's back.
And he will be clutch as time goes on.
No, he will. Dave Wright is back. And that just, there's been images all over the internet on Instagram of that fist pump. So much frustration. I think that was like so much relief just like was released when he did it.
I could watch that on replay for hours.
I know, literally, me too. Because that's when you see like the New York Metsies are back, guys.
I hate Metsies. You call them Metsies all the time.
Know,
it's so weird.
But I don't know. There's like this... every time I go to City Field, I keep hearing Metsies.
No, everyone, people call them that. Like, that's like a normal thing. I just like, oh, God. It makes me feel like they're like little infants. I don't know. Like,
I don't know, but they're becoming men now. They're growing up slowly. But David Wright, he did hit a home run in the bottom of the first inning to try to like make
the lead a little bit
smaller by 2-1. And then what happened was,
Harvey gave up one more run.
Yeah, it was an in the park. It was a little league in the park home run.
Cespedes error.
Yeah, no? Because that's Cespedes error.
But And then the Nationals just piled it on. 7-1.
Yeah, because it was supposed to be a single, but then it turned into an inside the park home run for Taylor in the bottom of the sixth inning.
Honestly, it took a bad hop. Like, you should have played it a little bit better when you know, when you know the stakes of the game.
You always get in front of the ball, though. That's what frustrates me with players.
Regardless of that, as an outfielder, you want to make sure that if you, like, especially in that situation, and you know the ball is going to be on the ground, you need to be up further quicker and, like, make sure that bounce doesn't happen. You're getting that ball as soon as you can so you can, because the bases were, you know, people are on base. So you want to make sure, you don't want to limit the amount. Your throw will be shorter. Mm-hmm. You want to limit the amount of runs scored.
Yeah.
So that you just need to play that ball better.
No, you do. And I feel like he needed to get in front of that ball. I hate when outfielders.
But I get what he was trying to do. He was trying to target and come up with the throw.
But
you got to play that safer in a situation as crucial as it was.
No, it does. And I feel like the right fielder should have backed him up a little bit. I feel like the right fielder should inch to try to back up Cespedes just in case it goes past him.
Yeah.
Like, it's typical baseball 101. I feel like someone should...
Who was in right field? Was it Granderson?
It was Granderson, and then Conforto played left field yesterday.
My boy Conforto.
And then Kirk Nieuwenhuis came in. But we'll get to that very soon. Captain Kirk.
Captain Kirk.
But, like, the stats that came up during the broadcast, which I thought were very interesting, was the Mets had a 30-1 odds to win the World Series, and the Nationals had a 7-1 odds in winning the World Series in Las Vegas.
Now, in Vegas, the Mets and the – well, as this is according to last week.
Yes.
The Mets and the Cardinals have the same odds to make it – to advance to the World Series, which is
okay,
insane and really exciting. It makes me all giddy. I'm so happy.
No, I'm excited, but we got to take one step at a time here. But
yeah,
but I like how Cespedes, he made up for that play. It wasn't an error, it was just a bad hop, but he made up for it. He came through in the clutch with bases loaded in the top of the seventh inning with a double scoring and three runs to cut
bases
the lead.
Clearing double.
It was.
He is just so good at baseball. It's like almost unfair.
It's just
unfair.
I love watching that swing.
And I am really excited about that. The talks between Cespedes' people and the Mets organization about extending the time that they have to talk to him about possibly re-signing him.
Yeah, they waived the release in the contract.
Amazing, because then at least the thought is like, okay, this guy is just not just a rental player. Like, how could you? This guy has been on the team since January. I mean, not January, July, and he's already he should end up probably being the MVP of the team.
Yeah, he's hit 14 home runs with the Mets so far since acquiring him. And
he's at, like, 20-something double. His slugging percentage is, like, almost a 700.
Absurd. Good job, Sandy Alderson, I must say, in acquiring him. And with the good news with his contract, because before, instead of the Mets having only 5 days after the World Series to resign him, so they would have 5 days to resign him, and after those 5 days were done, that was it. They couldn't have a chance to resign him. But now they have the whole offseason to try to work out a deal. Plus, other teams are obviously going to be involved. But at least the Mets still have the potential to resign Cespedes.
Right. Which is, there's no doubt in my mind. How could you not? How could you not resign this guy? Like, there's overwhelming evidence that he is making a difference on this team.
No,
as soon as he put on a uniform, we were a playoff contender.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah, yeah, no.
And that's the goal, right?
He adjusted well, though, to New York City. You know how players are a little bit,
I mean, but he's just so good at baseball.
How old is he? 29, right? He'll be 30 soon.
I have no idea how old he is, but.
His birthday's coming up soon, I think. I know he's going to be 30.
He is 29, yep.
Yeah, so
he's going to be 30 in the potential October run.
So he's going to be 30 when the World Series is over. But. Also, what I found interesting, Tyler Clippard, he spent 7 years with the Nationals, and when he came in to relieve, he struck out two of the three batters in the eighth inning, so he was pretty on point.
Let's talk about the bullpen, because that's been all the past few weeks.
Yes.
The whole Mejia nonsense. Ever since that happened again, the bullpen has been shaky.
Yesterday
bed,
was solid.
Like,
I must
the
admit,
last two
it was
games,
solid.
You know what? This is what I like.
Yes.
Terry Collins said, hey, like, this is the first round of the playoffs for us. I'm treating it like that. The team's treating it like that. Great, because the bullpen has been on Monday was superb.
Yes, it was.
Yesterday, again, superb.
Yes.
This is exactly how they need to play in the playoffs. And now,
but Familia, that closing situation scared me to death.
He gets flustered too quickly. But, like, I think being in these big games and still being trusted by the team to go in and finish them off is going to be good in the long run.
It's a confidence booster, right. But I feel like he does get flustered too quickly, and David Wright has to come up and just calm him down a bit. But
and you know, didn't he do that yesterday?
No, he did. But what gets me a little bit nervous, there was a runner on, I think it was second base, because he gave up a walk. It was a single, and then there was a bunt, and the advance to second, right? It was something like that.
You know what Familia has? He can't do the quick pitch like a lot of the people in our bullpen do. He just doesn't. He doesn't pitch well when he's focusing on doing that. He just needs to pitch his game.
Yeah, but he puts too much runners on base to close it. It gives it anxiety.
It's anxiety driven. Sure.
And it was just, and he walked. He walked a batter.
He always walks somebody.
So a single could easily tie that game.
But it didn't. So I know it didn't. It was a sloppy win, but it's a win. Right?
Yeah. So but against the Nationals and the way the game was going, I got a little bit nervous
just,
there.
Like, as a Mets fan right now, I'm a little bit more comfortable with the situation in the bullpen just based off of these two huge games and how they've come up and been have consistent, like pretty much, I mean, Robles, Clippard, and Familia. Despite the trouble he had, it was pretty clutch. Like, 7, 8, 9, and it was over. You know what I mean?
Yes. Like, I just get nervous. I just don't trust Familia.
It always could be better, but
as long as they get the job done, which is good, but you don't know what baseball, you don't know what's going to happen. That's everything's very, like, questionable with that sport, too. And we now have a 6-game lead in the National League East.
Exciting. And tonight, DeGrom's on the mound.
Yeah, we're going for the sweep, baby, against the Nationals, hopefully. Our magic number.
Honestly, going into the series, I was like, I would be happy with 2 out of 3. So
no, me too.
A sweep would be pretty sweet, but two out of three was crucial.
No, it was. We needed to win these games because going into the series, weren't we 4 games up? Right? And now we're 6 games up, which is good because, God forbid, we lost those 2 games. Yeah. It would have been 2-game. And that would have put Mets in a little bit of a predicament. But now our magic number, which isn't it great to have a magic number?
Yeah, it is.
It feels great again, right? It's now, I think it's 19 games to
clinch it. Is it 19? I know it was 21 after Monday.
Yes, I think it's 19 now to clinch it. To clinch the division.
God, that's so crazy.
And take a playoff spot, which is great.
Tara, I don't even think the listeners will be able to
understand.
To handle an October with hockey and Mets playoff baseball.
I don't think I could handle it.
I don't know if I can either.
Me neither.
It's going to be way too intense. Way too intense. We are not going to be able to do it. I don't know.
I know. Just stay tuned for October and see how Alyssa and I handle this predicament, which is
come
a great
back
one.
Every week until.
Come back every week. But we have to say congratulations to Bartolo Colon. He's the National League Player of the Week, guys.
This is the thing. This is all, like, competition was the best thing that could have ever happened to this team. Every player wants to be the number one starter, the outfielder, the middle infielder, and everyone's thriving off of it. So
it's
great. Bartolo for president.
Bartolo for 2020, baby. Bartolo. And well, he's National League Player of the Week because he went 2-0 with a 0 ERA in 17 innings. He's allowed 13 hits, struck out 11, and walked 1 over that span. And he became the oldest Mets player in history to throw a complete game shutout, which he did against the Marlins on September 5th.
Good for you, Bartolo.
Good for you. Keep doing what you're doing because it's working. Apparently for the Mets. I'm gonna say Mets, not Metsies. I know how
you can say Metsies. I mean, it's a thing. People do call them that. It's weird for me to say that.
Yeah. So tonight they're versus the Nationals again.
Last one, and then that's the third of the 6 games left that we have.
Yes,
so
and then they're back home, right?
At City Field on the second, third, and or maybe it's the first, second, and third. It's a Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Yeah, isn't it against the Yankees? I know the Subway
Yankees
Series is coming up soon.
Yeah, the Subway, that's going to be huge.
That's going to be a packed house at Citi Field.
Yeah.
It's going to
be
sold out.
You'll be there too, right?
I think
everyone has to work those days.
I know, because it's going to be packed. You never know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Well, Throw Like a Girl Radio is WBCR's first all-female sports talk show with myself, KaraAnne Galante, and Alyssa Paolicelli. We'll be right back with you after a short break. Here are some highlights from that amazing win against the Nationals.
Fortunate to be on some, you know, real good teams in Pittsburgh that won, but I'm not sure I was involved in a bigger win than that game right there. To be in the position we were in and to fight back against, you know, Jordan Zimmermann and Drew Storn and Jonathan Papelbon and come out on top is a huge salute to the guys in that room, the dress in that room. They I've told you that there's a sense of calmness and a sense, no sense of panic on the bench, and that's exactly what they went about tonight, and it pays off. I'll tell you, it pays off.
Terry, I know we use the word resiliency and have a lot recently with this bunch, but what is it? Can you put your finger on a tangible reason why this group is able to do what they do?
Steve, I wish I could. I'd can it if I knew, because, you know, again, I just think it has to do with character, and that's for me, that's a big value of any player to have. You know, to recognize what the situation is, to be accountable in certain situations, and you got to have character to be able to do that. And you're involved in a pennant race. They come out prepared to play. Guys are doing early work every day, and you know, this means a lot to everybody in that room. And even guys, you know, Juan Uribe's got two rings, and you know, he's the one guy in the clubhouse that keeps everything going and keeps everything, you know, laughing and loose and. Because he wants another one, and it's they're fun to be around.
Kirk's obviously been through waivers this year. He's been with another team this year. What do you feel for him right now?
Well, as you know, you guys know how I feel about him. When I first came to this organization as the field coordinator, I fell in love with the way he plays. Everybody thought this guy was going to be a great player, and you know, he's had a lot of injuries to different parts of his body, his shoulders especially, and you know, he had to change his swing. And then tonight, to be a part of this, I'm real, real happy for him. Well, you know, again, obviously in the first inning, you know, his command wasn't real good. And again, I think he was out there trying to show everybody he was who he is. And I think he overthrew a little bit, Mike, to be honest. I really do. I mean, you look at the replays and he missed a lot of spots. I mean, because he was trying too hard. And again, it's human nature. This guy is, you know, he's got the persona of something that, you know, he's just a player and a great one. But I was very proud of him. He would go out there with the monkey head on his back the way it was, and to carry that load out there on that mound is tough to pitch with, and he did the best he could.
So you just heard Terry Collins' post-game comments from last night, and you're listening to Throw Like a Girl Radio with Alyssa Paolicelli and KaraAnne Galante. We're with you until 12 p.m., so about 20 minutes left. If you want to join our conversation, the number to call is 718-951-4444, 718-951-4444. That's the cue for our hockey segment.
We're back.
A little bit, starting off on a kind of a, like a downer.
Yes, serious
but we can't
note.
Not talk about it.
Yeah,
Patrick Kane
to.
Is, I guess, would you say it's on trial or is awaiting grand jury appointment for allegations of a rape against a girl.
We don't even know the name.
Her name
we
is
know
not
she's
revealed.
Young.
Yeah.
I think she was 23 this or something, 26.
Oh, he's 20. He's 26.
So she was probably 26. Yeah, he is 26.
So
what made us talk about this thing?
I'm going to write a book
topic.
One day.
Yes, she is.
Sexual assault and like rape culture
sports.
Within sports itself. So
that's,
stay tuned.
That's a big stay tuned for Alyssa's debut. But what made us want to talk about it was the news came out yesterday that Patrick Kane is not participating in the NHL media tour because he was not invited. And the NHL media tour is about, you know, how the players take pictures with like the new paraphernalia and all that stuff. And
he's the face of,
and he's like the face. Yeah.
Of not only the Blackhawks, but is often associated with American hockey.
Yes.
Just the NHL in general.
And they didn't invite him at all. And these are all allegations. We don't know if it's true or false and all this stuff. So he wasn't invited at all. And what's with the NHL media tour, like they usually ask like one player from each team, but with the Blackhawks, they asked two. And it was supposed to be Jonathan Toews and Patrick Kane. But since this came up, now it's Duncan Keith. And that's an oddity that happens
right.
in the NHL because the Blackhawks are just so good. And they just recently won the Stanley Cup.
And they have so much young talent.
Yes. And it's just, and now Patrick Kane, he was taken off of the NHL 16 cover.
Was he? I didn't know that.
Yeah,
that's
and they
though.
Replaced
that's
him with Jonathan Toews. It's him holding the Stanley Cup, I think, or it's something like that. But the NHL is handling this pretty well, I'm thinking.
I agree, because I think that he's probably going to, if the grand jury appointment or whatever, it's, you know,
it was canceled, actually.
It was canceled.
Yeah,
he's getting
yesterday.
Postponed.
Yeah.
I believe that he's not going to be able to play in the NHL until this is all settled. If the NHL has learned anything from the NFL's mistakes last season, they will just, it just, it's one of those situations, like, I always think if someone is accusing you of doing this horrific thing, something didn't go right.
Yes.
Whether it was...
there was foul play somewhere.
Like, something was not comfortable. It wasn't a comfortable situation. Mm-hmm. Whether he is guilty or not, it's a different story. And it's almost one of those, like, it's just, you're never going to know, number one.
Yeah.
Number two, your career is always going to be tarnished by this. So
yes, yes.
It's really, it's going to, it's difficult to handle for the, on the Blackhawks end. It's difficult to handle
on
the NHL's end.
Yes, because he's a
star
player in the NHL. Like, the Blackhawks kind of need him.
It's so disappointing because there was just an article that came out right before the playoffs this year, and it was about how he's finally growing into the mature.
He's growing up.
Like, star that he was meant, destined to be. Like, he's not constantly out partying after games. He's not, you know, he literally in an interview was like, I just go home, I get prepared for the next game. Like, he finally, like, music to the Blackhawks' ears, finally this kid that is so, has so much talent.
Yes.
So, can produce so much on the ice, is finally taking it seriously and realizing that, like, this is, you know, he's buckling down into that competitive mode.
He's grown, and he's 26 years old.
Right.
It's not like he's a teenager or 21.
I mean, 26 is still young.
I know, but it's like, you've been in the league for it's not like I just entered the league and now I'm a party animal and I'm getting used to this hockey culture and trying to be a grown up. But he's a young man now. And I think he should have learned from
the past. He's been in
the
league since 2007.
Yeah. So almost, what, 8 years?
Yeah.
So since he was 18 years old, he's been in this league. So he's been around before. It's not like he's just entering the league. And what's confusing about this whole rape allegation is that there's no one straight story. I've read so many articles yesterday about this, and I've been just hearing and reading different things.
It's very ambiguous. They're doing it is. The investigative. I know when the story first broke, there was very little information about it. The Buffalo police or whoever was handling it was not releasing any information until they confirmed that this was, in fact, Patrick Kane who was involved.
Yeah.
The NHL didn't make a statement for a while, but there was all this speculation. It's just so hard to deal with, and I hate these situations. Cause,
no,
like
I hate
I said,
them, too. I used to, like, look
so
up to him.
So many kids do.
Yeah.
Like, so many kids have this guy's jersey. So many kids go on the ice every day and it's like, hey, I want to be like Patrick Kane. Like, that's the goal. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's heartbreaking. It really is.
No, it is. And they're covering up a lot of stuff. And what I got out of it, like, what happened that night is that he was at this popular nightclub called Sky Bar, and it was past midnight where it was a woman and her friend. They took, the police officer took them back to his house or something. Like, he was in the car, too. And they went back to his mansion in Buffalo, New York. And that's all we got from it. And the other thing was that the woman who claimed that she was raped by him, she didn't want to go to begin with. She just went with her friend just to make sure that
she would be okay.
She would be okay. Other than that, that's the only thing. There's no quotes from anyone. There's quotes from, like, the guy who drove the police officer or the security that drove them. Other than that, there's nothing else out there about the situation.
I think that part of the reason why the grand jury proceedings were called off could be, there's a number of reasons why it could have happened, but
yeah,
I'm thinking they're trying, like, Kane's people are trying to reach some type of agreement.
Yeah,
or,
monetary agreement.
Right, with this girl, so that they just don't have to do, because, like, their number one priority is getting him on the ice.
Yes,
and,
that's
you know,
it.
Training camp is starting real soon.
Yeah, and we don't even know if he's going to be invited
or
even
eligible to play. Like,
yeah.
Not eligible, allowed, the NHL.
Invited even on the ice
so
to even prepare for the upcoming season. It's just...
it stinks. It really
there was different like, people were saying there might be problems going forward with the case and not enough evidence. That's why it was canceled. Other reasons were they're trying to reach a settlement, like, off, like, the court, away from that. So you don't have to hear what she has to say. Because she had to testify. That's why it was canceled. Like, it was her and her friend going to testify and talk about what happened that night. And Kane's people apparently stepped in, and now they're trying to settle something. So it's just a crazy situation. But good news is Rangers
are back on the ice.
They're back on the ice.
They had an informal practice. I loved on Twitter all of the tweets of the guys coming back on into New York. Like, I love that. Like,
I love it. You see the pictures.
It's so exciting. It's so exciting.
Yes, Zuccarello is back. He's saying he's healthy.
He said he's good as new, quote unquote.
Good as new. So I believe him.
I hope so. Like, he's the biggest question going into the season. Is he going to be back 100% after experiencing that horrible concussion?
Yes, and want to wish a happy birthday to Keith Yandel today.
It's his birthday today.
It's his birthday today. Aww, happy birthday,
Keith.
And also
play
another
better next season.
Yeah. Yes.
Four more power play goals. Thanks.
No, yes. And also Chris Drury was named the team's director of player development. He'll be working with the hockey operations department and with the Hartford Wolfpack. So, you know, Chris Drury used to be the captain for the New York Rangers.
He was one of my sister's favorite players. She actually has his jersey.
I was those Ranger fan, that part of that group that wasn't a big fan as Chris Drury as captain, but we don't want to go into that. But he's back with the Rangers. He's back on the organization. And
I really love when teams bring back old players to, you know, to their front office. I think it just creates a greater sense.
It's great
for the fans. It's great for the organization. It makes the appearances a lot more fun.
Yeah. And he's been having a great year, too. He's been inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame. Chris Drury.
The U.S. one or the...
I think it was the U.S. one.
The U.S. one, yeah.
I think he was inducted into that. And now he's front office for the New York Rangers. He's back with them again, so he's having a decent year. I know he was inducted
US Hockey Hall of Fame.
Yeah, with Angelo Ruggiero. Yep. Yeah. He was inducted. So he's having a pretty good year. Pretty good offseason. Let's hope he, you know, continues greatness with the Rangers now, since
yeah, and especially he has a really important role in developing the talent for the future. And since we don't have any draft picks until like 2018,
yeah, since we gave them all away,
that's going to be important.
Acquiring, I think, Marty San Luis and Keith Yandel. So I know it's nerve wracking, but we'll see what happens this season, and we have more hockey talk coming up.
Yes,
the
I can't wait. It's so exciting. Training camps are starting, and I'm pumped. Yes. So ready. That's our woman of the week. We actually have two.
Yeah,
honorable mention
from yesterday.
But take it away, Kara.
All right, so our woman of the week is Jessica Mendoza. Woo!
Can I just talk about how I used to have a huge girl crush on her playing softball growing up and playing outfield for a little while?
Yeah,
she was my girl.
Yes. Well, now she's woman of the week for Throw Like a Girl Radio, and she is actually the first woman to work an MLB game for ESPN.
About time.
Yes.
About time.
She is replacing Curt Schilling now on, I think, Monday night games. Now she's replacing Curt Schilling because Curt Schilling made some controversial tweets.
He just doesn't know how to keep his mouth shut.
Yeah.
He's entertaining. He's an entertaining Twitter follow if anyone wants to be.
Yes.
Is looking for a good Twitter follow, but
yeah. So if you want to see Jessica Mendoza, she'll be on Sunday night broadcast for the remainder of the MLB season. She is a former U.S. Olympic gold and silver medalist. You go, girl. She played softball at Stanford and was inducted into their Hall of Fame. She was named Stanford's Athlete of the Year 3 times. She played for Team USA and the National Pro Fast Pitch League. She's actually the president of the Women's Sports Foundation, and this is actually a foundation that was founded by tennis legend Billie Jean King, and it focuses on advancing the lives of girls and women through sports and exercise.
Yay.
she's just great all around. And she's also, like, I think she brings a little bit luck to the broadcast.
Yeah.
Because on her second appearance, she was there during the Cubs pitcher Jake Arrieta's no-hitter.
Yes, I did see that interview.
Yeah, so I think she brings a little bit of good luck to the broadcast, too.
I'm looking forward. I will watch. Is it Monday night baseball season or Sunday night?
Remainder of Sunday night broadcast.
Because Sunday night broadcasts are usually a snooze fest. I'm going to be honest. I hate Sunday night broadcasts from ESPN. I hated when they did the Yankees-Mets series. It was just boring. But
I
can't wait to listen to her because I think she's gonna do a great job.
No, I think she's gonna do a great job too. And plus, she played softball, so she knows what's going on.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's great. Exactly. She has experience, and she has a gold and silver medal You know what sucks, though? It's not an Olympic sport anymore.
Well, that's because it's dominated every year by the U.S.
I know, but
it's always the same. The gold medal round is always like U.S. and Japan, U.S. and China every year.
Yeah, so I think we should just keep it as an Olympic sport. It's dominating. Just putting it out there, the Olympic Committee. And who is our honorable mention?
Serena Williams, the most, arguably, I can make the argument, she's the most dominant athlete in her sport.
Yes.
Ever. Like, she's not even just female. I think she's better at tennis than anybody is at their sport. Like, she's just unbelievable.
Yeah, she's
headed into her fifth U.S. Open final. She's 21-4 in major championship matches. She beat her sister last night, which is, that must be a bittersweet moment. Like, you're playing your sister.
Yeah,
you didn't win, but at least your sister won. I mean,
I don't know.
She's unbelievable.
What would the parents do?
they're probably making parents. I mean, they're taken care of, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's true. But it's still a competitive sport. I don't know. If I was parents, I wouldn't know how to handle that.
Everyone said she was struggling a little bit this U.S. Open,
mm-hmm.
But then obviously came out on top as she always does.
Yeah,
she's
always
just unbelievable. And best of luck to Serena. And she's our honorable mention for the week because she's just so, so good.
Yeah.
So good.
And how old is she?
She's 33.
She's 33 years old, and she's still rocking it.
Yep. So I think that was
a good show today.
It was. Tonight, the Nationals, Mets. Hockey's their prospect camp is starting soon. Can't wait.
Yeah, I'm excited to see the prospects and see what's going to happen with him. Brady Skjei, finally.
Yes.
He's up and coming. We'll see what happens. And he was a first-round draft pick for the Rangers, so we'll see what happens. And we're just going to now put it in the books for our second episode of the second season of Throw Like a Girl Radio. Thank you so much for listening to Throw Like a Girl Radio, WBCR's first all-female sports talk show. I am KaraAnne Galante.
And I'm Alyssa Paolicelli.
We'll be back same time next week. Remember, our new time is every Wednesday from 11 to 12, right before you take your lunch break. Don't forget to follow us on social media, facebook.com/throwlikeagirlradio, Twitter @throwlikea_girl, and Instagram, throwlikeagirlradio. We'll be posting this week's episode on our YouTube channel, and make sure to check us out on iTunes.
When we get up there,
and with YouTube, just search Throw Like a Girl Radio and subscribe. Today at 4, our intern from last semester, Samantha Rodriguez, is hosting her own show called She's Mic'd Up.
Yes, she's mic'd up. Change the name. She's mic'd up.
I like this much better. Show a girl some love. We are slowly but surely taking over WBCR Sports Talk, which is awesome. Go, girls. Remember, come back next Wednesday at 11 by listening to us on mywbcr.com or downloading the TuneIn Radio app and searching Brooklyn College Radio. 2 more days till Friday. Woohoo! And have a great week, everyone.
Let's go, Mets.
Yes.